In case study three, we see a fractured lingual cusp here on the lower seven. And when we look at the occlusion in general, we see worn canines and wear facets on the buccal cusps. So when we put the models together and have a look on the articulator, going to the work inside excursion, we can see there the worn canines, and we've got a group function between the 2, 3, 4, 5 and the 6. So you need to think about what happens when the canine wears and we lose the disclusion of the posterior teeth and we're gradually wearing into a group function situation. And we're thinking about particularly this work inside excursion. So here we're looking from the back of the mouth, and this is these are our ICP contacts, of course. And normally when we've got intact canines or good canine guidance, we see a large vertical component to the movement. So we see the disclusion of the posterior teeth when we go into this working side. And because we've got this large vertical component to the movement, the lingual cusp, as the mandible travels, will move down and move away from the palatal cusp. As the canine wears, we see the movement losing the horizontal, losing the vertical components and becoming more horizontal. And as a result, we see contact between the posterior teeth here and here. So we see the wear facets developing on the posterior teeth. And everybody notices the wear facets on the buccal cusps, but we don't really think about the ones on the lingual cusps. And if we've got a big amalgam in there, we possibly won't see a wear facet, we'll see fracture of the tooth. So a sound tooth would just exhibit a wear facet, whereas a compromised tooth may get damaged. So here again you can see the working side excursion, and we can see where the buccal cusps are contacting each other. And that's easy to see, but of course you need to open up and have a look at the other functional cusp, the palatal cusp of the upper, and where that's contacting when we go into that working side excursion. So there's the worn canine. Here's the wear facets on the buccal aspects of the teeth, buccal cusps of the teeth, sorry. And then we see wear on the lingual cusp there on the 6, and of course fracture of the 7. So what are you going to do about this? Well, if you're going to restore the lower 7, you need to make it so that the lingual cusp that you're replacing doesn't interfere with the working side excursion. If you want to restore it to its former glory with a lingual cusp, then you're going to need to create some disclusion of the posterior teeth. And to do that, you're going to need to restore the canine on that side. So you need to restore the canine guidance. So now you've got a tricky conversation to have with a patient that wants a tooth repairing, that you've got to do a restoration on the canine before you start restoring the damaged tooth at the back of the mouth. So the ways to restore canine guidance these days with some composite. This is the sticker that comes for your book. Or you could also place a palatal veneer, a gold veneer, to restore the guidance. More typically, though, a direct composite restoration. Okay, that's about it for number 3.